Good morning, students. I'm Dr. Lata, Principal Scientist, ICR NPPGR Region Station, Trichur. You know about NPPGR, National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources. So this institute, its headquarters is in New Delhi, and we have 10 different region stations located all over India based on the agroecological zone. Okay, Trichur, it is located in the southern zone, and it is meant for all the PGR activities of the southern region, that is Kerala, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Lakshadweep, and Andaman and Nicobar Island. So today we are going to see about how we are acting, how we are managing the plant genetic resources, and our topic will be today conservation and utilization of germplasm. Okay, so what is plant genetic resources? See, we have different crops that have evolved from previous years. Okay, suppose if you are having a rice, it has been evolved from the wild relatives and it has come to the rice crop which we are cultivating. So it will take thousands and thousands of years to evolve as a crop. So those crops which have been evolved from the wild relatives, their improvement, and all those wild relatives constitute the plant genetic resources of that crop. Okay, so now we are having 24,000 plant species that are described as edible, and out of it only 3,000 are grown for human purpose, and out of this 3,000 also only 30 plant species are utilized as 95% for human basically. So 24,000 plant species are known to us, they are edible also, but out of this 24,000, only 30 species we are using for our consumption. So now coming to the germplasm, what is a germplasm? It is just sum total hereditary materials of all the genes present in a crop field. So if you are having a green gram or black gram, it is called as Vigna mongu or Vigna radiata. So that Vigna mongu, what are the diversity, that is what are the variabilities that is present in the crop, their wild relative, everything, and if breeding derivatives, everything will constitute the germplasm of that particular species. So it can include seed, it can include the pollen of the crop, leaf tip, rhizome, whatever the material that it can be propagated or it can give to the next crop, it is called as germplasm. So it is a storehouse of for our plant breeders. So plant breeders, if they want to go in for a new varieties or new specific breeding purpose, where they go only for the germplasm for selecting the material. So what does germplasm include? Germplasm include the materials that are derived from the centers of diversity, areas of cultivation, and derivatives from breeding program. Now, centers of diversity means what are the materials? See, each crop has its own center of origin. So now, if you say rice is a center of origin is Southeast Asia, and our center of origin we have crops like Vigna mongu, radiata, red gram, etc. Now, from the materials derived from those center of diversity are primitive cultivars, that is the farmers which have been cultivated for a long time, those materials, land races, that is named land races, that is in Malayalam we can say tavala kannan in rice or kunju kunju in rice, like with different name, each variety is having a different name, those are called as land races. Then natural hybrid. See, so Vigna mongu or wood bean, it has derived from Vigna sublobata into Vigna mongu variety silver steel. So they are natural hybrid. So those natural hybrid. Then Vigna Mangu means it's wild. There are many number of wild relatives are there. So those wild relatives and the related species and genera. So these all these constitute the material, germplasm material from the centers of diversity. Then based on the areas of cultivation, we have commercial type of variety. Whatever varieties that are cultivated commercially, if the varieties may be derived from our own institute, or it can be released from different universities, or it can be released from the private university which are cultivated commercially. So those commercial type and obsolete varieties. Obsolete variety means variety which have been once cultivated, now it has not been cultivated. Those obsolete varieties, then primitive varieties, then some special purpose type. Those materials also constitute in the germplasm. Then we have in germplasm we have derivatives from the breeding program. That is, we have plant breeders after developing a variety, they may be having a different stock. Those pure lines, elite varieties, polyploid mutants, etc. So these constitute the germplasm. Now coming to the actual activities of NDPGR. So it is a plant genetic resources management. So we mainly have four different activities. One is exploration and collection, another one is characterization and evaluation, and then conservation, and finally utilization. So we are talking about germplasm. Where can we get our germplasm? That we have to go in search for the germplasm. So how do you go for search for the germplasm? We have to conduct different exploration and collect the material. So exploration will be based on special crop, I mean a specific crop, like we go in exploration for rice, or we go exploration for millet, or we will go in exploration for all pulses, like that. Like specific crop, we go exploration for a specific crop and we collect. Suppose we can also go for exploration in a specific area. Suppose a tsunami has come, or suppose a flood has come, so we go in for exploration in that area so that we can get crops or wild relatives that are resistant to this flood, or resistant to the tsunami, resistant to the drought, etc. So like we go exploration for a specific crop or also specific region. Then after we bring all the samples to our institute or college, whatever it is, what we will do, we have to characterize them in our field. So that is called as characterization and evaluation. That is characterization for different characters, either morphological or physiological or quality, etc., whatever it is. So that is a different story, and we are not going to deal about this today. So exploration, characterization, evaluation, and then after evaluation we will find out the trait specific in each accession. That we call the different materials that are collected is called as accession. So suppose we are collecting 10 different varieties of rice or 10 different land races of rice, we are giving one accession number, so that is called as accession. So those accession, what we will do, we will go in for conservation, and then after conservation we will give it for utilization. So now we are going to deal only about conservation and utilization part. Now what is conservation? Yes, a small definition from the IUCN. So conservation means whatever things which are conserving will be used for this generation, and we have to conserve it for our future generations also. That is called in a simple term conservation. Okay. So conservation. Now here you see, these are the primitive forms, wild species or land races or traditional bird, whatever I told you earlier. So these are the primitive forms. So these, they are developed into a new variety. You see the different, these are having different characters. You see the colors, these are having different color, and the internal genotype, they are having also different color. But what happens when we breed as a variety? It becomes uniform. You see the central genotype, these are all becoming uniform. Okay, so these are the modern varieties. So what will happen to these modern varieties? It will be again susceptible to some other diseases or anything, and it will be banished. and again we will go for the germplasm from the gene bank or whatever it is. So again the breeders will be breeding it for a different time. Okay, so this is in a small about why we have to conserve the germplasm. Okay, what is the need for conservation? So for, you know, the forest areas have been reducing, we are building new buildings, we are, the population is more, and we are going to build build all sorts of what you called all sorts of buildings, houses, etc. So we are going to lose many of our plant species. So genetic erosion is another factor. Genetic vulnerability is another factor. Genetic wipeout is another factor. You see in this picture, a man is taking a medicinal crop. This is called as Tynospora cordifolia, or in Tamil you call it as Chittamarthi. Okay, so this is being harvested from the forest in a very mass way. Can you? So if this is being taken out like this, naturally the crop will be, or the species will be reducing. Okay, so what is the science based conservation behind this PGR? So how this NPPGR has come? So it was initially developed at Botanical Garden 1787, and then it was named as Executive Conservation of PGR in IRA 1905, and later from that division it has been separated into national, that introduction division has been separated into National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources in 1976. And now NPPGR is a nodal organization for all the PGR activities in the country. Okay, PGR activities of the plant species. So we are having, for forest species, we are having FRA, and for plant species, we are the nodal organization for getting the material, sending the material, distributing the material. Okay. Now, conservation strategies, what are they? We are having basically two different types of conservation, ex situ conservation and in situ conservation. So what is ex situ conservation? It is conserving outside the area. Suppose we are having one crop species which is having a center of diversity, center of origin in a particular place, a particular forest area. This is predominant, suppose a black pepper, it is predominant in the forest area. Now we are bringing it and growing it in our institute. So that is called as ex situ conservation. Suppose any seed crop, we are bringing the seed and conserving it here in the seed gene bank. That is ex situ conservation. So what are the things in the ex situ conservation? Examples, method, seed gene bank, where you bring the seed and store, in vitro storing, that is we are bringing the leaf tip or rhizome tip, everything. So that is being stored in the in vitro. Then field gene bank. Suppose vegetative material that can be grown in the field gene bank. Suppose cryopreservation. Cryopreservation is for the recalcitrant species. Okay, that can be cryopreserved. Then we have DNA storage, pollen storage, and botanical garden. These are called as ex situ conservation. So what is in situ conservation? It is conserved where it is. So suppose if you are having an area that is fully with the full diversity of a piper species, then we conserve as such in that area itself. We are giving, we monitor it, we'll go in there, we monitor it, what are the species available, what are the species going to be lost, like that. So that is called a genetic reservoir. And for cultivated crops, it is called as on-farm conservation. Suppose a farmer has many traditional varieties of a crop, example rice or whatever the crop may be. The farmers are encouraged in conserving those germplasm in his field itself, so that it is maintained forever and conserved there itself. So that is called as on-farm conservation. Now this is the example for ex situ conservation. Now here we have, this is called a gene bank. This is collection of seed samples at one location and transferred to gene bank for the storage. During the storage, the seed sample is reduced into its suitable moisture percentage. That is 8% is the about the question for the seed to be stored. So we bring the seed, dry it, and then we conserve it in the gene bank. That method next we will be seeing. Okay. Now, seed storage conservation, we have basically active collection and the base collection. Active collection means the materials we are frequently using those seeds. So that is called as active collection. And base collection means those seeds, those which are not at all disturbed in the gene bank. That is called as base collection. So the active collection means the working collection, or the collection which are taken for multiplication, regeneration, supply, etc. And those materials which are giving for supply, those are called as active collection. Then, next is the base collection. That is, it is stored for a long-term period. And the storage condition should be optimum. And it will prevent the genetic erosion of those accessions. Okay, so active collection and the base collection are the strategies of conservation. Now, what are the different methods of storage? Short-term storage, medium-term storage, and long-term storage. What is short-term storage? It can be the seed that can be stored only up to 18 months. What is medium-term storage? The seeds can be stored in a storage up to 3 to 10 years under 20 to 40% RF. 3 to 4 degrees centigrade. So this medium-term storage forms the active collection. We store in that medium-term storage facility, and the materials are taken for characterization purpose or evaluation purpose, or materials are taken for supply. Somebody asked for the material, we take it for supply the material. Then what is long-term storage? These are collections which are conserved indefinitely for longer period. The temperature will be 3 to 7 degrees centigrade and minus 18 degrees centigrade is temperature, and 3 to 7% is seed moisture content. So long-term storage is the we are having a long-term storage that is called as National Gene Bank, that is present in National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources at New Delhi. So whatever material we are collecting, we just characterize it, evaluate, and then we send it for the long-term storage at the National Gene Bank at New Delhi. So seed material will be sending for a long-term storage, and the vegetative material, that is rhizome or tuber, whatever it is, it can be sent to the tissue culture storage. And the species which are having recalcitrant, I think you may be knowing what is recalcitrant. The recalcitrant seeds are seeds which are, it cannot be stored for a long period. The seeds are having the capability of germinating immediately. So those seeds can be stored in the cryopreserves. Okay. So short-term storage, medium-term storage, and long-term storage. These are the three different types methods of storage. So this is the example of in vitro culture, where we are storing banana germplasm or ginger germplasm, black pepper germplasm, turmeric germplasm, etc. Okay, where the materials are propagated by through vegetative means. So in vitro conservation is meant for vegetative propagated crop, and the plant species which are having longer life cycle, and the seeds are produced after long period. So those can be also stored in vitro method. And the seeds, the plant species which are having recalcitrant seeds, those can be also stored in the in vitro culture. And we are also having a slow growth media, so that the materials will be kept, the seeds will be, the material should be kept in that, and it can slowly grow in that media, and it can be conserved for a longer period. Okay. Then cryopreservation, I know is the method, recalcitrant seeds that are stored in the minus 196 degrees centigrade, that is called as liquid nitrogen, and those recalcitrant seeds are stored in the cryo tank. Okay. So this is a long-term conservation method for the vegetatively propagated crops and the recalcitrant seed crops. Okay. So under liquid nitrogen, all the metabolic activities of the seeds will be arrested, and so it is kept in a dormant state. Okay. Then next is our common field gene bank, where all the crops are grown in our field itself. So this is on rock which is called as taro or called in Tamil chembu polychaetia esculenta and these are the garcinia species in our farm which are conserved in the field. This is a botanical garden. This is the picture of a botanical garden at Kew, Royal Botanical Garden, Kew in Britain. So naturally, what are the advantages? All the crop, we can see the crop directly, okay? And we can educate all the children and whosoever coming. We can see we can show the crop and explain to them what are the different types of plants or everything in the field chamber. Then what are the disadvantages? The germplasm will be prone to all sorts of disease and pest, and it requires a larger area and it requires larger maintenance. So these are the disadvantages. Okay. Then the nowadays a recent trend is DNA and the pollen storage. The pollen can also be stored in the cryo tank. DNA is also is stored in the molecular lab, etc. Okay. So in India we have 25 biosphere reserves, 489 wildlife sanctuaries, and 89 national parks. Okay. This is the genetic reserve. What I was saying was the institute of conservation. So it is maintained in the forest region itself, where it has origin. The materials are made, the species are maintained there only. So these are some advantages and disadvantages of this in situ. So this is called as on-farm conservation, where the farmers are involved and the crops are being cultivated in those region where the farmers have once cultivated in that area. So this is an example in the Sikkim region. You know, Sikkim is an organic farming state. The main activities of the Sikkim region is the on-farm conservation only. Okay. So in our NPPGR National Gene Bank, we are having in long-term storage, we are having 445,573 accessions of different crop germplasm, wild relatives, etc. And in medium-term storage is present in 6 different regional stations. And a total of 92,576 accessions are being stored there. And in cryobank, we are having 13,936. And tissue culture repository, we are having 1,889. And in field gene bank with entire NPPGR, we are having 1,74,172 accessions. So these are the different conservation strategies or conservation conserved material of our National Bureau of Plant Genetics. Now, these are some you may be knowing. These are some examples of where the germplasms are maintained outside India. So we are having two where this multi-crop is being maintained. Small grains are conserved in the west with the USA. Sugarcane is being conserved in Florida, USA. Groundnut in Senegal, Africa. Potato in Chile, Peru. We have many examples that you can get from anywhere. Then, coming to the second part of our lecture, is called as utilization. So, the domestication of crops have started since 8000 BC. And 3000 BC to 1900 BC is the golden age for adaptability. So, this period is called as adaptability of the crop. And next, from 1901 to 1965, where the scientific base of the plant cultivation has come. So this is the period where scientific involvement was present. Then in 1965 to 2000, all these high yielding varieties or widely adapted high yielding varieties, everything have become in a wider way. So 1965 to 2000 was that period. Then 1965. During this period also, we are everything was revived through the ex situ collection. We go in for germplasm collection, bring back the collection, etc. Now, this is the period which we have come to. So what will be the next step? So we going for collection, we are characterizing, we are conserving, and next what we will do with the conserved material? The next phase will be the utilization. So now utilization is the major area which we have to concentrate, because whatever the material, so we are having some 4,45,000 material, just keeping the material inside the gene bank is of no use. It has to be utilized. So we are supplying all those material to whoever we need, that is for research purpose, for students, for breeders, for different institutes. Then we supply materials outside India also through bilateral agreement, etc. So utilization has to be given higher priority. Okay, how the utilization can be? Utilization will be fruitful only if we do the systematic evaluation for different characters and documenting. So this accession is good for yield, this accession is good for this superior quality, that is suppose if it's wheat, for good, it's a good bread quality, or if you are having a disease resistant, this accession is good for this biofistic, this accession is good for abiotic. So we have to classify those germplasm into different groups or different specific use, etc. So initially we are having a passport data during the data which has been collected when exploration has been done, and then we are having the characterization data and the field evaluation data. Then we are having preliminary evaluation data, and then further evaluation and characterization data will be there after collected. So these are some of the examples where in wheat now we need a stable resistance to different races of rust. Rust, and semi-dwarfness, improved quality, tolerance to drought and cold, wider adaptivity, etc. So in germplasm we used to search for these characters. Likewise in rice also, we go in for higher yield potential, wider adaptivity. Now the climate change is very much crucial, that we have to go for germplasm that are suitable for different climatic adaptation. Then for potato, it is for virus resistant, nematode resistant, etc. For tomato, keeping quality, etc. Then in some horticulture crop, we search for better roots process. So this is the example of the different germplasm that has been utilized in our utilized from our gene bank. Okay. So frequently, only the elite varieties are used by the breeders. Suppose this in rice IR8. This variety is utilized in developing 83 varieties of rice. This TN1 is utilized 48 varieties of rice. Pangas is utilized to develop 19 varieties of rice. Likewise, same varieties is used for number of times using the same varieties in for breeding different varieties will also have a negative impact, that it can be vulnerable to pests and diseases. Okay, so we have to go in for utilizing other germplasm which are having a wider genetic space. So these are the example of some varieties which are developed from a common pedigree. Okay, so all these contribute to a narrowing down of genetic space. So we have to go in for a germplasm that can broaden our genetic base. Okay, so I'm just showing a photograph. These are the different cultivars of sesame. Okay, you see the variation in color. You have white, you have dark black, and light black, light red, etc. Yes, this is called as Garcinia gummicata, or you can see Malabar family. So these are the variability that we have collected from Western Ghats. You can see the variability in the fruit. This is the big fruit, pink fruit. Then you can see the variability in the shape, So this is the Malabar tamarind, which is commonly used in Kerala for making fish curries and all. Instead of our common tamarind, we use this Malabar tamarind in fish curries, etc. for food preparation. And you know, Malabar tamarind is the best medicine for this obesity and all. This Garcinia has becoming very important now. Okay, I'm just showing the picture to show you the variability, how in a single crop, how the variability is. So, Varaisa Nivara is a source of resistance for rice tungro virus that has been explored for resistance. Okay. See, tomato, the common tomato now has gene derived from all these species. See, Lycopersicum peruviana for vitamin C, Lycopersicum pimpinellifolium for color, Hirsutum for pest resistance, then this species for quality. This species for drought resistance. This is for jointless broodstock. So all these wild species have contributed to our modern tomato. Okay. So this is a small example. Okay. Now this is called as Oresia rufifolium. Okay. This is called as Oresia rufifolium. It is also a wild native of Oresia, and it has the cross compatibility with the rice, and it can be used for drought resistant ad. Okay, this is called as Varaisa Meiriana variety granulata. This is a very rare species of Varaisa, where this spike will mature within a day and falls off the same day. Then this is called as Sesamum Lysiniatum. This is another wild variety of Sesamum. You can see these are the wild relatives of Solanum, Solanum insanum, Solanum acutaceum, Suratans, etc. This can also be used for the plant breeding purposes. This is Vigna acornutifolia, Vigna radiata variety sublobata. These are the wild relatives of Vigna. This is Silverstress. So why this utilization of germplasm is poor? So because the non-availability of germplasm for the breeder, which he is interested. Then lack of proper evaluation of the germplasm. All the germplasm are not being properly evaluated or not. It has been properly documented. So, and another main thing is difficulty in maintaining the germplasm, because the wild relatives has its own nature to be, and its own its own capacity to live in the ex situ way. So we have difficulty in maintaining the wild germplasm. Now, what are the recent concept in this utilization? It's the concept of core collection, concept of pre-breeding, use of molecular markers, biotechnology tools, and genomics. So what is the concept of core collection? So suppose if you are having a rice, it has in the total number of germplasm in rice is above 2 lakhs in our gene bank. So we cannot go and study all these 2 lakh germplasm and make it a document. So what we are doing is core collection. We take out the sample. There are some different statistical techniques. We take out the sample from the 2 lakh, so that it can represent the entire 2 lakh. So this core collection will be containing only 10% of the total germplasm. So that it will be, if we have 2 lakh germplasm, only 20,000 will be our core. I mean 2,000 will be our core, and this 2,000 will represent all the 2 lakh sections of germplasm. So that is a concept of core collection and concept of pre-breeding. Suppose the breeders will be taking so long to get the variety to be adopted. So what we do is we cross some species which are belong to primary gene pool and the tertiary gene pool, and we make some lines which are easily compatible with the cultivated crop, so that the breeders can use readily for his studies. Okay. Then use of molecular markers is another tool, and biotechnology, other biotechnology tools also, and genomic studies also another concept of portfolio. So what are the strategies for enhancing plant germplasm utilization? So systematic evaluation and multi-location evaluation, then publication of catalog and active breeders to get that. We are conducting field days and all, the breeders can be actively involved in that germplasm field day so that they can select the materials needed for them. And another approach is participatory approach for germplasm also, and developing data bank and put it in the website so that readily available to all. Then we need to conduct also basic research, like what are the taxonomy, what is the species, what exactly the species is, etc. This should be also done. Basic research is also needed. Okay, and germplasm enhancement is also to be done. Then what are the challenges before us on efficient conservation and utilization of germplasm? So coordination among the different institutes that are involved in the PGR, capacity building, encouragement of science for plant taxonomy and biosystematics. So because many people do not know what is wild species, what are the how the species are identified based on the taxonomic character. So those things also need to be improved. Scientific based conservation is also necessary, and determining the molecular diversity among the different axes, and measuring the genetic erosion, how it can be done in the region level or local level or national level, etc. And database of all the activities of PGR is another important thing. It is not at all being proper in our country, and it has to be improved a lot. And there should be a dynamic link between the conservationist and the breeders. Thank you, friends.